It's so good to see you guys. I've missed seeing you. How long has it been since I saw some of you? A couple weeks. Yeah. Some of you have been sick. I'm sorry you were sick. I know. I didn't get sick this time. I'm very thankful. But I want to tell you about a time when I did get sick. But I didn't mean to. It just happened. So I want to tell you, are there sometimes you choose to be sick?
No.
You don't? What happens when you eat too much sugar and your stomach hurts? Did you make that choice to eat all that candy?
Yeah.
So you chose to be sick. I say that to myself all the time. Now, what was I thinking when I did that? That didn't turn out so well. Well, when I was a little girl, my dad was a surgeon. Do you know what a surgeon does? What do they do?
Operate.
Operate.
What do they do when they operate? What's operating?
Fixing something inside of them.
That's right.
They take out things that don't need to be there.
Or they take out things that should be there, but they're sick. They have something wrong with them. Well, one night I was at home. It was Saturday night. We love Saturday night. Because my mom had a long walkway in our house that was made of tile. And it went from the dining room, through the living room, and all the way to the family room. There were four sliding glass doors along that walkway. And my mom kept that tile clean and waxed. And on Saturday nights, we'd have supper. When I grew up, it was called supper. And then we'd put on thick wool socks, and we would start in the dining room, and we would run. And when we would hit that polished tile, zoom, you could just fly down that tile.
In our old house, we had a hall that was like that, and I'd start in the office and go, and then I'd go flying down the hall and slide on my socks.
Yes. Yes, so it was so much fun. And Mom didn't let us do it all the time. But it was a Sabbath evening special. And we were running and playing and running and playing when all of a sudden, right at the top of my leg, it started to hurt so badly. Well, Mom had just said, go get ready for bed. So we got ready for bed. We had our pajamas on. And I came to my daddy. And he was the one I always told if I wasn't feeling well, because he was the doctor. I said, Daddy, it hurts right here. So he looked at it and he said, okay, now take a big deep breath and cough. And I took a big deep breath and I coughed, and I was looking where he was looking. And when I coughed, it was like a little balloon went, just bulged out like that. Can you puff one cheek out? There you go. And I started to cry. I was horrified. I had a balloon in me. But my daddy, he hauled me and he rocked me and said, it's okay. But he was kind of chuckling. He said, I've been expecting this for a year now. Now, why was he expecting me to have what we call a hernia? Because my identical twin sister had one a year before on the same side. And so he knew that if she had one, that probably I had one, and he wasn't surprised at all. But I want to tell you the coolest thing. I had a daddy that I loved so much, and wherever he was, I felt safe. And he loved me so much that I was never afraid. He loved me so much that even when I grew up and went away to school, I wanted him to be proud of me. And his love protected me from doing things that were wrong or getting into trouble. Because I knew that my daddy loved me so much, I didn't want to disappoint him by doing something that would cause trouble or sadness. Well, that was Saturday night. Monday morning, my dad came and woke me up. Not my mom. My mom always woke us up in the morning and said, come help me make breakfast. But that day, my dad came to my bed. He had a big blanket. He picked me up with that blanket, he wrapped me in that blanket, and he put me in the car and laid me down in the back seat. He said, you can keep sleeping, and he drove me to the hospital. Got to the hospital, and the nurse helped me get into that little funky gown, funny gown, and I was on a stretcher, and they took me into the operating room, and I saw the nurse was going to stick a needle in my vein, in my hand, and I looked over, I could see my daddy over at the sinks washing his hands, and I looked at the nurse, and I said, please don't do that. I said, oh my, in your tooth. Not much fun, but you know what I said to her after I said, please don't do that? I said, please let my daddy do that. And so my daddy came and stuck the needle in my vein. I didn't move. I was only about 5 or 6. I didn't cry. I just laid there. Why? Because I trusted my dad. My dad was doing it. And I knew, what did I know? That he loved me, and he would never do anything that would really hurt me. So then they gave me the medicine. I went to sleep, and my dad cut me open, took out the weak tissue, and sewed me up, and they woke me up. And I was fine. I went home that night, and I went running down the sidewalk. No, I didn't feel good. I didn't feel so good at all for several weeks. I didn't want to run and play. It actually hurt. But afterwards, was I mad at my daddy? No. I knew that what he had done had helped me, even though I was hurting a little bit. I knew that I would be okay later. I want you to know that God loves you so much more than your mommies and daddies. And he's like a big father to all of us. And no matter what comes to you in your life, is it going to be okay? It's going to be okay. Because guess what? God knows the end of the story. He wants you to know that everything, no matter what hurts or hurts you or is bad, everything will turn out just fine in the end. Will you remember that? Say the promise with me. I'll say it first. God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Would you say that with me? I will never leave you or forsake you. That's his promise. He is with you always. You may go back to your seats.
All right, we'd like to have you join us in singing hymn number 330, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Take my life and let it be, consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy. Silver and my gold, not a night would I withhold, not a night would I withhold. Take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart. Lord, I pour. At thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee, ever only all for thee.
Amen. Next, I'd like to have you join us in singing hymn number 99. This one's titled, God Will Take Care of You.
Dismayed, whate'er betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day. Toil when your heart doth fail, God will take care of you. When dangers fierce your path assail, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will. God will take care of you. Nothing you ask will be denied. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care. God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon his breast, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care. Will take care of you.
Amen.
I wasn't here at the very beginning to remind you what this Sabbath is. This is a fifth Sabbath. It's a month when there are five Sabbaths. If you didn't know that before, that happens four times a year. That's why our Sabbath school lessons come in sets of 13 instead of 12. So on every fifth Sabbath, since August of 2020, we have been having a time when we share our faith stories with one another. In August of 2020, I was sharing with you about the vision Ellen White had of the white cords that come down from the celestial city that we hang on to as we go to the promised land. And now in this world's history, we're at the place where we're hanging on to these cords. We don't know from one minute to the next what will happen, as we saw today. And the more we hang to the cords, the thicker they grow and the more sturdy they grow. But if we look down over the cliff, over the abyss, to all the craziness going on in the world and all the controversies going on in the world, we will slip off that white cord. You're welcome to go back and listen to that talk. It's in our archives. It was called Let's Imagine. But we began then to share our faith stories with one another. And also then was added from our children and our youth department, memorizing scripture and sharing that with one another. We call it All Children in God's Family because at every age, we are still God's child. So you will notice as you think back on today's service that we will have every age involved. Right now, we are going to have a special feature of two people who are reciting or memorizing scripture, Emily and Jennifer Martin.
My child, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in mind. Then you will live a long time and your life will be successful.
Don't ever forget kindness and truth. Wear them like a necklace. Write them on your heart as if on a tablet. Then you will be respected and will please both God and people. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and don't depend on your own understanding. Remember the Lord in all you do and he will give you success. Don't depend on your own wisdom. Respect the Lord and refuse to do wrong. Then your body will be healthy and your bones will be strong. Honor the Lord with your wealth and the first fruits from all your crops. Then your barns will be full and your wine barrels will overflow with new wine. My child, do not reject the Lord's discipline, and don't get angry when he corrects you. The Lord corrects those he loves, just as parents correct the child they delight in. Happy is the person who finds wisdom, the one who gets understanding. Wisdom is worth much more than silver, and it brings more profit than gold. Wisdom is more precious than rubies. Nothing you could want is equal to it. With her right hand, wisdom offers you a long life, and with her left hand, she gives you riches and honor. Wisdom will make your life pleasant and will give you and will bring you peace. Just as a tree produces fruit, wisdom gives life to those who use it, and everyone who uses it will be happy. The Lord made the earth using his wisdom. He set the sky in place using his understanding. With his knowledge, he made the springs flow into rivers and clouds drop rain on the earth. My child, hold on to wisdom and good sense and don't let them out of your sight. They will give you life and beauty like a necklace around your neck. You will go on your way in safety and you will not get hurt. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. When you lie down, you will sleep in peace. You will not be afraid of sudden trouble, and you will not fear the ruin of the wicked. Because the Lord will keep you safe. He will keep you from being trapped. Whenever you are able, do good to those who need help. If you have what your neighbor asks for, don't say, "Come back later, I'll give it to you tomorrow." Don't make plans to harm your neighbor who lives nearby and trusts you. Don't accuse a person for no good reason. Don't accuse someone who has not harmed you. Don't be jealous of those who use violence, and don't choose to be like them. The Lord hates those who do wrong and is a friend to those who are honest. The Lord will curse the evil person's house, but will bless the home of those who do right. The Lord laughs at those who laugh at him, but gives grace to those who are not proud. Wise people will receive honor, but fools will be disgraced.
All right, I feel, since I am in charge of the children's division, in a way, that if I ask the kids to memorize something, I should memorize something as well. So I've been very proud of them for working hard. And so today I'll be sharing Psalms 115, which I've been studying Psalms in my private devotion every morning. And when I ran across Psalms 115, it just kind of struck home. It does mention the house of Aaron. My husband's name is Aaron, and so I don't know, there was this personal connection that I had with this passage. So it says, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but to your name give glory, because of your mercy, because of your truth. Why should the Gentiles say, 'So where is your God?' But our God is in heaven. He does whatever he pleases. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. Eyes they have, but they do not see. They have ears, but they do not hear. Noses they have, but they do not smell. They have hands, but they do not handle. Feet they have, but they do not walk, nor do they mutter through their throats. All who make them are like them. So is everyone who trusts in them. O Israel, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is your help and your shield. May the Lord be the Lord has been mindful towards us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, both small and great. May the Lord give you increase more and more, you and your children. May you be blessed by the Lord who made heaven and earth. The heavens, even the heavens are the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the children of men. The dead do not praise the Lord, nor any who go down into silence. But we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord.
So the reason I did 1 Kings 3 is because in Pathfinder Bible Experience, we were studying 1 Kings and Ruth. So I said, why don't I get some extra practice on it? So that's why I'm doing it. Now Solomon made a treaty with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and married Pharaoh's daughter. Then he brought her to the city of David until he had finished building his own house and the house of the Lord and the wall all around Jerusalem. Meanwhile, the people sacrificed to the high places because there was no house built for the name of the Lord until these days. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed at the high and burned incense at the high places. Now the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night and said, "Ask, what shall I give you?" And then Solomon said, "You have shown great mercy to my your father David, because he walked before me in truth, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart with you. You've continued this great kindness toward him and have given him a son to sit upon his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king instead of my father, but I am a little child and do not know how to go out or come in, and your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to be counted or numbered. What? Therefore, give to your servant a wise and understanding heart, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours?" The speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. And God said to him, "Because you have asked this thing and have not asked riches, long life for yourself, nor have asked for riches or honor, nor have asked for the life of your enemies, but have asked for understanding to discern justice. Behold, I have done as you have said. See, I have given you a wise and understanding heart to discern justice, so that there has not been anyone like you before you, nor shall any like you arise after you." To what?
And I have also given you what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall not be anyone like you among the kings all your days. So if you walk in my statutes to keep my commandments, then as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days. Then Solomon awoke, and indeed it had been a dream. Then he went to Jerusalem and stood before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, offered up burnt offerings, offered up peace offerings, and made a feast for all his servants.
And at this time, Charlie is going to read the scripture that we usually or often have on this All Children's Day. This about encouraging one another.
Good morning. Our scripture reading today is found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, and verses 23 through 25. Let us hold firmly to the hope we came to have. The God who have promised is faithful. Let us consider how we can stir up one another to love. Let us help one another to do good works. Let us not give up meeting together. Some are in the habit of doing this. Instead, let us encourage one another with words of hope. Let us do things even more as watching you, Christ's return approaching.
Thank you. So today we have two people to encourage us. And I think, let me just set the stage because it's already a few minutes to 12, but we've been asked when we are finished today to leave out the front, to not go through the fellowship hall. And we will not have the potluck that some were expecting, but we will start a plan for taking food to the Willis family. At this moment, because I'm standing here and I'll find paper and pen, we don't want it all to come at once. So I would like you to contact me about when you can do that, and we'll arrange when you can do that. If you can't take it to them yourselves, you could bring it here. I live just across the street and I could deliver it. But we'll try to arrange that after the service in the foyer. But at this point now, we have Grace, who's one of our mothers in Israel, to tell us a little bit of her faith story, and then Carla. Johnny couldn't be with us, and he left a story, but we don't need it today. We have plenty to fill our time. So Grace Conniff.
My early life revolved around my mother's grandma's seizures, and it was traumatic for a little kid. And so I realized at an early age that I needed God. My parents took us to church every Sabbath, so I knew God. But I learned a lot more when I went to Catholic school. I went to Catholic school for 12 years, actually more. And I never questioned anything because the people who taught me were godly people. And I loved God with all my heart. The crisis came later for me. I didn't learn until after I was married that my husband wasn't that interested in religion, and he had a very bad temper. I believe part of the problem was caused from an injury that he got when he was playing football. He got a severe concussion, and that can cause some of the behavior. Maybe all, I don't know. But I found it difficult to live with all the abuse, especially to my children. We had 8 children, 2 girls and 6 boys in that order. And there's a Catholic teaching that there's grace in the sacrament for every situation, so I just prayed a lot. Several years later, my husband made a very bad business decision that devastated him, and he was diagnosed as homicidal and suicidal, and the medications gave him hallucinations. So they said the only alternative was to do shock treatments. Well, the shock treatments didn't really cure the anger, but they made him a zombie. And it was very challenging to keep a sense of normality for the family in that situation. One night I was praying the rosary, and I just told the Lord, I needed more. Now, in a city where we lived in the San Francisco Peninsula, we lived in San Carlos. At that time, there was about 30,000 people in the city. There were 3 Adventists in the city. You see how God answers my prayer. 6 weeks later, I met a woman at my daughter's school. And she asked me if I wanted Bible studies. I said, yes, I did. And at that time, the Catholic Church was in a lot of upheaval. You know, it was in the change from no more hymns to Mary, the people singing, going from Latin to English, there was a lot of upheaval. And so there was a lot of turmoil. Plus, during that time, I sent my oldest son to be an altar boy. And he came back home saying, Mom, that wine and that bread is not Jesus' body and blood. Oh, I didn't know what I was going to do with him. I knew I had my hands full. So I was ready for a lot more. Now, Mary Lou took me for the first year to Bible study fellowship. I don't know if it's interdenominational, but it's a group of women, and you go and study the Bible every week. And I thought I knew the Bible, but I was overwhelmed because there were so many scriptures. I didn't know anything. One of the scriptures that came across was, I was very familiar with because it was from the liturgy for the Mass for Mary. And I realized at that point it wasn't talking about Mary at all. It was talking about Jesus. And I was really upset about that. So after the year was over, she asked me if I wanted more Bible studies. And I said, yes, I did. And it was really wonderful because I learned I didn't have to do more penance to get my beloved grandmother out of purgatory. We had already tithed, that wasn't a problem, and the house message was wonderful. But the most important one of all was righteousness by faith. No more works to appease God and to please God. So 50 years ago, I was baptized. It was the best decision of my life. After all these years of learning the Bible, I feel there's just so much more I want to learn. And I just want to share with the members how much it's meant to me to be a member of this church. I was disillusioned when I came here, and this church for our church family has been a marvelous source of healing and growth for me, and I really appreciate that. This is the Reader's Digest version. I'd love to share how God has given my prodigal son a ministry of healing emotional wounds by identifying with Jesus' suffering, just like us, to heal us, and how my son has written 2 books. He has a ministry that's gone halfway around the world. There's one text that has become very important to me that I just learned recently. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. I am very thankful.
Amen. And now, Miss Carla.
Is this on? Okay. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Carla Mace. And it's going to be hard today to speak. I first would like to introduce you to 2 visitors today. my friend Randy in the back pew, say hi. And an old friend of mine, Wally Howard, is here today. He was the president of the bank that I used to work for many, many years ago. Thank you for coming. And Wally's a Nazarene, but we still love him. When Kathy asked me to speak today, I thought, gosh, there is nothing interesting about my life to share. It's boring. And I thought, well, what would be interesting? What do I think is interesting? And I thought, well, maybe it's how I became to be. So I decided to go back, as far as I know, in my history. And I want to talk about my great-grandfather. His name was Polite Mace, and he was born in New Orleans in 1845. At the age of 17, in 1862, he decided he wanted to come to Idaho. And the only way to get to Idaho from New Orleans was by sea. So he got on a boat, and he went around Cape Horn. If you know anything about Cape Horn, it's the southern tip of South America, and it's where the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans meet. And it creates this low pressure system, and it creates abnormal activities, high winds, whirling winds, high waves, and a lot of boats don't make it, but his did. He went all the way around and all the way up the southern, or along the Pacific coast, and got to the Columbia River. 9 months later, 14,000 miles. Then he came up the Columbia River and up the Snake River and made it to Boise, Idaho. Now, why would he do that? Gold had been discovered in the Boise Basin in 1862. By the time he arrived, he was 18 and it was 1863. Now, if you're not familiar with Boise Basin, it's a 300 square mile area, 25 miles northeast of Boise, and it encompasses Idaho City and Placerville, Pioneerville, Centerville, Grimes Creek, that area. When he got to Boise, there wasn't much. There was a blacksmith shop, livery stable, a couple of shacks, and Fort Boise had just been built. And that year he got here, Idaho finally became a territory. And it was huge. It was bigger than Texas. There was no Oregon, there was no Washington yet. And he didn't come here for the gold. Most people came here to find their fortune at the gold mines. He didn't come for that. He came for something that he thought was more valuable than gold, land. Because the Homestead Act of 1862 was passed, and that was where you could get 160 acres. All you had to do was fill out the application, pay a $10 filing fee, and you had to live and work the land and improve it for 5 years, then it became yours. And that's exactly what he planned to do. He'd already found his spot. He filled out the form, and he chose the place on an island because there was water. So he immediately joined a pack train to Idaho City. By this time, 1863, there were 16,000 people living in that 300 square mile, panning for gold and so forth in the Boise Basin. But 6,000 of those people lived in Idaho City. Idaho City was the biggest city in all the Northwest. And so he joined a pack train, and a pack train, if you don't know what that is, it's a team of horses that pull a wagon full of supplies up to the mining camps. He joined that and went to Idaho City, filed his claim, and then he got work by driving stagecoach from Idaho City to Boise, and then also Silver City, because gold and silver had been discovered that same year. So he did that for a while. And then he worked at a livery stable in Boise. And Boise had now Fort Boise had just been built because there were still uprisings of the Indians, and Boise had just gotten plotted about 10 blocks, so it was beginning to form. So anyway, he earned enough money that he was able to buy his own team of horses, a wagon, supplies, a plow, and he headed west, 7 miles west of Boise, to his little piece of land that he claimed on an island. The island was formed by the Boise River. It's where it forks, and it meets up again, and the island was 5 miles long and a half a mile wide, and some areas was a mile wide. No bridges to the island. You had to find your own way, and he got on his piece of land, and he was going to work it. See, he found that his fortune was going to be in agricultural, raising hogs and cattle to feed the miners. That was his goal. There had already been a man already on the island that just claimed the same time as he did, so they became fast friends and neighbors. And you have to realize that there was nothing around. There's no electricity, there's no neighbors, there's no towns, there's nothing. And you have to survive on the island. And so they became fast friends, and they named their island Eagle Island because of the abundance of bald eagles that inhabited the island. Well, you can imagine what life was like back then. I mean, Idaho didn't even become a state for 42 more years. There were no towns. The town of Meridian didn't even exist for 30 years. But finally, in 1889, there were 30 homes between the island and Boise during that 7 mile stretch. 30 homes. 11 years after he'd been on the island in 1874, he got married. He married the daughter of the person who owned the livery stable where he used to work. And they had 8 children. 3 of them died at infancy, but they were left with 5 boys. The oldest one being Charlie, the youngest one being my grandfather, born in 1889. So by 1990, a bridge was put over the river. And you can imagine what it was like, because when the flooding happens now during the spring runoff, there was no such thing as Air Rock Dam, Anderson Ranch Dam. There were no dams. When it melted, the snow melted, and it caused flooding, it was atrocious. It was spread clear across the valley. Well, that's why you get the bench in Boise and the bluff that follows all the way down Shinden Road, all the way to Caldwell. That was all formed by the flooding of the river. When the river would flood during the spring from the runoff, sometimes the river would be a mile wide, but not the island. They always had that strip of island where they settled was the high ground. So anyway, in 1904, Eagle finally came to happen. They plotted out 15 acres, and there was now a school, fellowship hall, or a Odds Fellow Hall, so forth. And in 1908, there became a Seventh-day Adventist church in Eagle. So back to Charlie, the oldest boy. He had a son, and they called him Whitey because he had such light-colored hair. And all the boys and all their families farmed on Eagle Island. They owned now about over 1,000 acres of the island. And in 1931, I'll fast forward, the pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church came to visit. He came to the island, and he found Whitey out in the field, and Whitey was harvesting hay. So he walked out there and he introduced himself, and he had a conversation with Whitey. And this was a Sabbath afternoon after church, and he asked Whitey, "Do you believe in God?" And they had a little conversation, and then he said, "Do you believe in the Ten Commandments?" And they had a little conversation. And then the pastor just explained to him what the fourth commandment was all about. And then as he got ready to leave, he probably invited him to church the next Sabbath. But instead of leaving, he did something else. He took off his suit coat and his hat, and the rest of the afternoon, he helped Whitey bring in the hay on a Sabbath afternoon. Whitey was so impressed that him and his wife went to church the next Sabbath, and they became members. And Whitey spread the word to all of his friends and all of his family, and the little Eagle Church grew. And Whitey had three sons, and those boys could sing, and they were singing in church all the time. And they graduated from Jim State Academy, and then two of them in their later life moved, in their young life, moved to Portland. And the two boys and one of their wives started a singing group and sang in all the churches, and they called themselves the Mace Trio. And they cut a couple of records, and then they grew and increased their gospel singing and changed their name to the Rose City Singers, and they sang all over Portland. And then one of the brothers went on his way, moved away, and the younger brother decided to continue with the gospel group, and he moved to California, and he changed their names to the Heritage Singers. They sang gospel all through the world, every country. They did this for 50 or 60 years until he just passed away last year. Now me, back on Eagle Island, I'm a fourth generation on the farm. I hated it. I hated on that tractor. I hated it. I could hardly wait till I got my first job at 13, even before I could drive. But my grandfather, he was a Baptist. He was a Baptist 40 years before he ever knew anything about the Seventh-day Adventist. My mother, she would take us, me and my sister, to the Methodist Church in Eagle. But when we were little, about 5 or 6 years old, they would come, my relatives would come, they were all over the island, and they'd take us to Vacation Bible School at the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Eagle. So we knew about them. But I tell you, the only thing I really knew at that age was, one, they went to church on Saturday. I didn't understand that. Number two, they wouldn't watch TV on Saturday. I didn't understand that at all. And number three, they couldn't eat hot dogs. Now, what is up with that? I didn't understand. So I'll fast forward. My sister, she gets married. She wants to start a family. They decide they want to go find a church. It just so happened that Cloverdale was having an evangelistic series. So they went. They were baptized. They joined the Eagle Church. I was living in a little town called Horseshoe Bend at the time. I would talk to my sister. She would tell me what she learned. She would explain the Bible to me of all questions I had, which was very little. She explained the fourth commandment. It finally started clicking why the Seventh-day Adventists were going on Saturday. About a year later, I moved to Payette, and I started attending the church in Payette, the Seventh-day Adventist church there. Of course, I only went when it was convenient, when I wasn't having anything else going on. I would, a lot of times, go home for the weekend on the island, spend time with family, and I would go to the Eagle Church with my sister. I knew I wanted to be baptized. I knew I needed to be baptized, but life takes you in different directions. Fast forward 20 years, things happened. I finally had the opportunity. I said, this is it. It's time. Time for me to start going to church. I want to be baptized. So there was a church, Seventh-day Adventist Church of Meridian, was located at 10 Mile and Cherry Lane. That was only a block away from my home. So I started attending. And it just so happened that Cloverdale was having evangelistic series again. And so I went every night, and I was baptized. And I joined the Meridian Seventh-day Adventist Church. And after I'd been there a couple of months, They had the burning of the mortgage. Found out that the church had only been there for 7 years, and they finally got it paid off, and they were ready to start phase two of the building, which was a sanctuary. All they had was classrooms, foyer, and a fellowship hall. They'd been meeting in the fellowship hall, so now it was time to build a sanctuary. So the board picked 5 people to be on the building committee, 4 men and me. Why me? Well, because I was the new kid on the block, and they couldn't find any other volunteers, probably. But our first meeting, the 4 gentlemen elected me as the chairman of the building committee. And it wasn't because I had any experience in anything or any knowledge. It was because none of them wanted to be the chairman of the building committee. So we found the old blueprints. Now, many of you know the story, but I'm going to give you a few details. On the blueprints, it showed this fellowship hall, how it was supposed to be built. And I took those blueprints to a friend of mine who was a retired contractor, and I said, find out how much it's going to cost us. We're going to have to borrow money. I need to know how much. And he said, the blueprints aren't good anymore. He gave me a figure, but he said, you're going to have to get new blueprints. These are too old. The city will not accept them. So I went to an architect. So let's fast forward. Pastor gets a phone call. There's a developer that wants our property. It was 3.5 acres along with the church. He wants to buy it. Pastor said, no, we're getting ready to build on. A month later, get another call from another developer. We would like your corner at 10 Mile and Cherry Lane. Pastor said, no, not interested. Well, we found out that's because the interchange was going to be going in on the freeway at 10 Mile, and that was going to open up that whole area. Our little corner became a hot commodity. So we continued and trying to figure out how we were going to build that sanctuary. And we get another phone call from developer number 1. He raised his price, and pastor said, better take this to the board. So we thought about it, and we thought, well, that's quite a bit. Maybe we could find a piece of property, build a church with a sanctuary with that kind of money, and then not have to borrow any money to build a sanctuary on our existing church. Well, I did. I met with a contractor, got some figures, I crunched some numbers, I went and looked at property. Wow, this is going to take a lot of work. Dealing with the city, ACHD, clearing land, all the work that was going to go into it. Oh my gosh, I didn't have any knowledge. It's going to take a lot of money. Found out that wasn't enough money what they were offering. So, in the meantime, developer number 2 called. He raised his price. No, not even close enough. So we continued. Then it happened one night, 9:00, I was home. Developer number 2 called, and he said, now we're offering this amount. He says, let me tell you, we are the exclusive developer for Walgreens, and we want that corner. They want that corner. And he said, this is what we're offering. And I said, no, can't do it. And he became frustrated, and he said to me, how much is it going to take to get that corner? And that frustrated me. And the next thing came out of my mouth, I swear, were not my words. The Holy Spirit put these words in my mouth, I swear. I fired back at him and I said, I'll tell you what it's going to take. It's going to take for you to go buy a piece of property, build us a church with a sanctuary, and when it's all done, you're going to give it to us. Then we'll give you our property. And it was dead silent on the phone, and I waited. And he finally said, you know, I think we might be able to do that. I think we might be able to work something out. He says, promise me you will not sell your property to anybody else until I get back to you. I said, no problem. Okay, well, fast forward again. Here we are, in meeting after meeting after meeting. I was meeting with their architect. I was meeting with their electrical engineer, their plumber. We were trying to get everything. This was going to be a complicated contract because it was called a turnkey agreement. They were going to do exactly, they bought this 5 acres. They were going to build us a church exactly like what we had. It was 5,000 square feet. He was going to build the sanctuary with the baptistry and everything that was on our plan. And then they were going to give it to us, and we were going to give them their property to build Walgreens. We were just about ready to sign that agreement when the lady that was in charge of the developer said, "Oh, by the way, Walgreens wants to be open by Christmas, so that means we need to break ground right away. And we're not even close to breaking ground on your property. So we're not going to be able to give you that church until later. But we need your property now." And the poor pastor, Gary Gans, you could see it in his eyes. He was going, "Oh my goodness, my children, my flock. What am I going to do? Where are we going to meet? Where are we going to, you know?" You could tell he was just worried. And my thought was, ding, 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 negotiating power, yeah. So I said to them, "Oh my, where will we meet? We'll have to find another church. We'll have to pay rent. Some people might leave and go to other churches. We might lose some. They might not come back. This is really a hardship on us." And they said, we know, we would really appreciate if you would grant this. It wasn't the original agreement, but if you would allow this." And I said, "Okay, as long as you remember that we are giving you this big favor." Excuse me. So we signed the agreement, everything was in place, and then I get a phone call from the developer, and they say, "Oh, by the way, we're going to be breaking ground in about 30 days, and we're going to be bulldozing down your church. We know it's only 7 years old, but it's got to go. Now, if you want your church, you can take it off the property. Maybe you can sell it, but it's got to be moved by this date." And I said, "Okay. What about the 2 storage sheds we have out back? Those have got to go too. They're going to be bulldozed." I said, "Can we keep them?" "Sure." I said, "Will you move them? Will you move them to this new property?" "Okay, we can do that." And I said, "And by the way, we want our steeple. We want it off the church, and we want to be able to put it on the new church. Will you move it to the new property?" "Okay." And then I said, "Can we have our trees?" They said, "Sure, we're going to be getting rid of those trees." So we hired somebody to move those mature trees. Those are the 8 trees that are sitting out front of the church today. We lost 2 of them we had to replace, but the rest made it. Okay, let's fast forward. I called the pastor that same day, and I said, "Guess what? They're bulldozing our church. They've offered it to us if we can sell it. We haven't a place to move it, so we need to sell it." He went down, and the next day, he had a big sign out front of our church, and it said, "Building for sale, must be moved." And then he's got my phone number on there, and I said, "Oh, thank you very much." So I started getting phone calls, and I got the phone call from the Friends Church on Pine Street, 1.5 miles away. "We would really love your church. We really need your church. It's 5,000 square feet. It would work perfectly on our behind our church." And he said, "How much are you asking for it?" And I said, $100,000. "Oh, wow, that is great. It costs us $500,000 to replace that building. I'll get back to you." He comes to our board meeting, and he said, "You know, we've talked to the city, the planning and zoning, they're requiring so much. Talk to the movers, it's going to cost a lot to move it. Is there any way you can come down in your price from $100,000? We would really appreciate it." And Jennifer Martin pipes up at the board meeting, and she says, let's sell it to him for $80,000. Seconded, so moved. I called him the next day, and I said, okay, $80,000, how's that? And he goes, oh, that's wonderful. You guys are great. We'll take it. And I said, would you allow us to possibly use your church on Saturday for the next couple of months before our church gets built? And he goes, well, sure. So no rent, rent free. They allowed us, because we dropped our price by $20,000, they allowed us to stay in their church for months and months before our church was even broken ground. So, what's next? The church gets cut into three pieces. It gets moved at 2 a.m. in the morning, one piece at a time for 3 weeks. Finally, come spring, we're going to be breaking ground on this property. The Walgreens Church is up before Christmas. What's next? I was working for a company. I was their controller. I quit my job. I spent every day on this project for the whole summer here. And the Holy Spirit worked on me like you cannot believe. For being a new Christian, I just could not believe how God led me and worked with me and everybody, and how it all came to pass. We took the $80,000, and $30,000 were spent on these pews. And then it came to me. This sanctuary will fit 250 people. How in the heck are we going to all have potluck in a fellowship hall that's only 30 by 30? And I realized we need to double that size, 30 more feet. And we're going to need more than four classrooms. We need more down this way, more classroom. And I thought, oh my gosh, you know, I have some leverage, some negotiating powers, but nothing that's going to come close to that. They'd already done a lot for us. So I called them and I said, this is our problem. And I explained the problem to them, and I said, we need more. I said, I know the blueprints are done, every contract signed, all that, and you're ready to break ground, haven't poured the cement yet, but we really need more room. What's it going to cost us? Would you check with your contractor and see if it's feasible? She says, boy, if you're going to build on, you better do it now than later. And so she came back to me and she said, yeah, the contract says no problem. He'd be glad to add on 30 extra feet. And I said, how much? She said, $50,000. It's exactly what we had left after paying for the pews. Can you believe it? So finally, September 2006, we had our first church service in here. And they gave us all kinds of things. I every time I thought of something, I said, you know, I want different windows in the sanctuary. The original blueprints had a sidewalk going out the back to the back office. I said, I want that moved inside. And she said, you want a sidewalk on the inside? And I said, no, I want a hallway that goes back here. And I want this opened up in the windows. And I want a little window in that kitchen so everybody can see what's going on. And they upgraded all kinds of things, and they bent over backwards. And it was just a miracle. So here it is, September 2006, we have our first service. So from the time that we formed that building committee until the time we had our first service in here was 4.5 years. So, you see, that pastor from the Eagle Church who came out to the farm to visit Whitey, he really wasn't helping Whitey bring in the hay. He was planting a seed. And that seed went far and wide through this valley and through the world, through the gospel singing. And you just never know how far a seed will grow. He, I'm sure, has no idea how far that seed he planted grew. But he will find out someday. When Jesus comes and takes his children home, he will find out exactly how far that one seed grew. You never know how your own life is going to affect others. So I encourage everyone to go out and help someone, help a stranger. And don't be afraid to say, "Do you believe in God?" Plant your seed. You just never know how far that seed will grow. Thank you.
And the only way we're ready to do that is to turn our eyes on Jesus, right?
Please stand with us as we sing together. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life ever lasting, he passed and we follow him there. O'er us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Dear Father, thank you for being with us today. We needed to be together to hear your word, to hear our stories shared with one another. We need to continue into the week, exhorting one another, encouraging one another, because obviously the time is short. Whether the time when you will come or the time when we will sleep in you, we want to hang on to the promises, to the things we memorize in the Bible, to your guidance of us day by day. Please go with us into this day. please, into this week. Please be with the Willis family in a very special way. We thank you so much for being our God and providing for us so wonderfully. In Jesus' name, amen.